Thank you. I'm very sorry for sending a paper kind of like twice as large as it was expected, and I'll do my very best to fit in 12 minutes. So I'm continuing this debate about the role of the far right in the Maidan protests, and the positions in this debate, I guess, are known. On the one side, there is a dominant narrative that the Maidan protests were largely peaceful, self-organized, crowd-funded, and where the radical nationalists played only a marginal fringe role, greatly inflated by Russian media in order to discredit those protests. On the other hand, there are research like mine. This is the slide I showed 3 years ago, the systematic protest event data showing that the radical right were the most active collective agents in the Maidan protests, and Svoboda in the total protest, the right sector in the violent protests. There are other people like Ivan Kachinovsky or Serhii Kudelia making the same argument with different data. And this question is very, very important, not only to understand what the Maidan was, how it happened, and why it succeeded to overthrow the President Yanukovych, but also to understand the origins of the war in Donbass, and also to, it has policy implications, how should we deal with the anti-democratic tendencies out in the post-Maidan Ukrainian political regime, with the construction of the freedom of speech, construction of political liberties, human rights violations, and so on and so forth. And the position that stands that the far right were insignificant, unimportant, marginal, so on and so forth, it actually is, it has an implicit theory about why Maidan was successful. So this theory is quite naive. It essentially says that it large number of people mobilized in the capital in Kyiv. Then they were outraged by the governmental repressions, and then they were radicalized, and then they won. The theory is naive and miss kind of things. And if you look to the Maidan from the point of view of social movement studies and comparative revolution studies, the number of questions we need to address. First of all, okay, the large number of people is important, but how we sustained the prolonged mobilization of such large number of people in multiple regions for several months? How they were coordinated? Repressions are actually, in many times, are successful. The government is usually able to repress the protesters. Why in Ukrainian case the protesters backfired, and why the protesters were able to withstand the repressions, and how they increased the pressure on the government. And finally, how this revolutionary situation was created, the multiple sovereignty situation was created, when the claims to control the state by the revolutionary coalitions were supported by a significant number of people living on a large territory, and the state was not able to repress it. Instead, the law enforcement and the elites were starting to defect from the regime. And I'm trying to apply the radical flank effects theory coming from the social movement studies to this case. And essentially, it's quite simple. So the scholars are speaking about the negative radical flank effects when the radicals are discrediting the movement, they're pushing away the moderate supporters, they make the international support more difficult, they provoke repressions from the government. Also, they speak about the positive effects when the presence of the wild radicals may the moderate win of the movement to look more negotiable. And so it makes the negotiations and the compromise with the government easier. But the problem is that to have this kind of effects, there should be a real distancing of the moderate win of the movement from the radical win. And there is even rational choice modeling of this radical flank effect. So, for example, when the moderates signal to the government that they are ready to distance, then they, we may have either positive or negative radical flank effect depending on the vulnerability of the government. But if the moderates do not distance, essentially then it's a question of who is stronger, the government or the movement. And I argue that in case of Maidan, despite all the criticism against the radical slogans, against provocative actions, there was no real distancing from the moderate opposition side, from the right sector, from the Svoboda and from other radical nationalists. And my analysis is based on a huge set of interviews our team conducted this year, mostly, and last year, with Maidan and anti-Maidan participants, with the law enforcement officers. Among the Maidan and anti-Maidan participants, we tried to reach both political protesters and also moderate activists, radical nationalist activists, the elite supporters. And what is the most important, we tried to cover the all the geographic regions in, macro regions, not oblast, but the west, center, east, south. So we conducted interviews in 10 Ukrainian cities with a special focus on Western Ukraine, where actually the most interesting events were happening, at least not less interesting than happened in Kyiv. And what is following is generalization from the interviews, also obviously checked with other sources to triangulate the conclusions, and analysis of perceptions of the participants in the Maidan and the protests of the radical nationalist role in the Maidan. So here I'll be very brief. The radical right brought a number of committed ideological activists to the protests, and Svoboda Party was bringing the largest numbers, not among the all protesters, but compared to other political agents. And they contributed an essential share of money. For example, the major sponsor of Svoboda Party, Igor Krivetsky, for several years telling in interviews that he actually spent $2 million to support Maidan. And despite all the crowdfunding, there were long periods of time, for example, during the New Year's holidays and Christmas holidays, where all that crowdfunding was given only a very small share of the money that were necessary to support the Kyiv Maidan camp, and that money were covered by the party's sponsorship. And the parties, particularly Svoboda Party, they paid overall something like 30% of the money that were necessary to support the Maidan protests. And Krivetsky himself, he bought the major scene, the central scene of the Maidan that was in the Maidan of Independence in the center of Kyiv. And of course, we should not take these revelations at a face value. But multiple informants are telling about how the local authorities in the Western Ukraine were crucial to support the protest camps, that they were supporting with the scenes, with the sound equipment, with money, with clothes, and so on and so forth. And these local authorities at times in 2013 and 2014 were controlled by Svoboda Party, which actually won local elections in 2009 and 2010. Svoboda Party was leading the coordination structures, the so-called Штаб національного спротиву, the national resistance headquarters that were organized in most of the cities to coordinate the Maidan protests in the localities. And they were leading them, and they played an important role in organizing and coordinating the protests. And because of this, they influenced the slogans and demands of the movement. Because we already discussed it in the previous sessions that the people were protesting against corruption, against police repression. But the protest against corruption, police repression, was not necessarily needed to be under the slogans "Glory to Ukraine," "Glory to the heroes," or "Glory to the nation," or "Death to the enemies." Right? And why these slogans appeared? Because the radical nationalists were so active, and they were actually ideologically committed to propagate within the protest, unlike the other parties. And so the obvious counter argument to this, okay, so Voda was active, but it's also like Batkivshina or Udar. The problem is that Voda was really very much different from the moderate opposition parties. It was not just an electoral machine. It was an ideological mobilization parties with a large network of ideologically committed activists. And if the formal membership could be even smaller than the formal membership of Batkivshina and Udar, but the quality of that membership was much higher. And it is also seen in the interviews, the even very critical towards Svoboda people, they usually make this difference, that they were bad leadership, corrupt, indecisive, and so on and so forth. But on the other side, there were very many very good people in among the rank and file Svoboda activists that made a huge contribution to the Maidan protests. And so, yeah, okay. Probably five, sorry. So my argument is that Svoboda had a unique constellation of unique features that made it so much prominent in the Maidan protests. So it combined the ideological ideologically committed membership with resources of the parliamentary party, and they also controlled the local authorities in the regions with the largest support for Maidan, and it was also not an accident that they won elections in 2009 and 2010, not the moderate opposition parties. So if I have really little time, the argument about the right sector and influence on the radicalization of the Maidan protests is essentially the same. Yes, the right sector and Svoboda and the Patriot Ukraine, they made the backbone of the self-defense structures in many regional cities during the Maidan protests. And why they were so prominent? They were not just ordinary radical people. The radical right possessed a unique constellation of advantages that made them so much prominent, because they had skills for violence, they had training, they had experience, also like soccer ultras, also like Afghanistan war veterans, but also they had the political organization that could coordinate the application of the violent skills. And they had a revolutionary strategy, very conscious strategy. They were preparing for the revolution against Yanukovych for many years before. And here, about the perception, like the dominant perception among the informants, that actually without the radical right, we would be still standing on Maidan and waving the lighters, like during the first days. And usually this perception is precisely about the right sector, but not about Svoboda. And people usually criticize Svoboda indecisive leadership, Oleg Ternibok, and so on and so forth. But from Svoboda activists, they have an explanation for this, because they were heavily involved into the negotiations with Yanukovych, which was mediated by the international diplomats, and actually the United States Department and European Union commissioners, after the violence started at Hrushevskoye Street in the middle of January, they demanded from the Maidan to dissociate from the radicals, to dissociate from the right sector. They were telling this explicitly in their official statements. But despite of this, the opposition didn't do any serious distancing from them. So they could criticize, but they didn't. They never condemned. They never stopped cooperation. They never, moved the protest to the other part, to the other square or whatever.
We need to
conclude. And they were calling them provocation, but they were not really, really distancing. And the result was not exactly the pushing away of the moderate public, but rather polarization, because an unexpected consequence of the radical right participation in the Maidan was that they actually increased the morale of the Maidan supporters in the southeastern regions when they were facing not only the law enforcement, but also the mobilized anti-Maidan people. And in the same time, they polarized the opinions there. And I don't really have time for this and coming to the conclusion. The radical right played probably an indispensable role in the mobilization, coordination, defense, radicalization, and transfer of power. This happened not because of some accident, and the right sector could not be replaced just with some left sector, but it happened because the radical right possessed a unique combination of advantages that led them to seize the opening opportunities during the Maidan protests. The radical flank effects didn't actually develop fully because of the lack of the distancing from the moderate opposition. And in the end, we had what actually the model predicts. Both the moderate and radical wings of Maidan won in different ways, but they won with all the accompanying problems, with the lack of legitimacy and polarizing the southern and eastern regions. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you.